Hi again, everyone. I'm hoping you're enjoying our stroll through all sorts of fascinating black hole-related topics. There are a couple more topics we can cover, including one where, over cosmic timescales, black holes can evaporate into nothingness. This mind-bending phenomena is the topic of this week's episode of Subatomic Stories. One of the commonly held features of black holes is that they suck things in and nothing can escape. That seems familiar enough, but in the 1970s, Stephen Hawking tried to combine quantum thinking with black holes and found that this wasn't exactly true. Hawking claimed that black holes could emit radiation that we now call Hawking radiation. There are a number of ways to visualize how Hawking radiation works, but a simple mental image is my favorite. Basically, the idea is that all of space is full of virtual particles appearing and disappearing. I talked about this in episode 9 of this series. If these virtual particles are appearing and disappearing in the vicinity of the event horizon of a black hole, they'll be created temporarily with a little momentum, and the momentum will be in opposite directions. This momentum will kick one particle down below the event horizon, and the other will be kicked away to escape. The escaping particle will carry away the energy and reduce the mass of the black hole. Now, there are some common reactions to this explanation. The first is that some people will ask how this reduces the black hole's mass. After all, I just said that it absorbed a particle. The answer to this is that you have to think of the black hole as not just the singularity, but the entire product, from the singularity to the event horizon to the distortion of space surrounding the horizon, the whole enchilada. When a particle escapes the vicinity of a black hole, some of the overall energy is lost. The particle that falls into the hole was already there, and part of the hole's energy. It just moved from one place to the other. If black holes radiate energy, then they must have a temperature. The temperature for a non-rotating, electrically neutral black hole is equal to 6 times 10 to the minus 8 Kelvin divided by the mass of the black hole in units of solar mass. For example, for a black hole with 10 times the mass of the Sun, you divide that number by 10. That's a crazy small temperature. The temperature of space is 2.7 Kelvin, which is the remnant temperature of the Big Bang. That means that black holes will absorb more energy from space than they emit. That'll be true for a long time, but eventually the expanding universe will drop the temperature of space to below the temperature of black holes. At that temperature, which will of course depend on the individual black hole, they will emit more radiation than they absorb. If an object emits more energy than it absorbs, it'll lose energy. And since E equals mc squared, that means that the black hole will lose mass. That will lose mass slowly. In fact, we can calculate the lifetime of a black hole. It is about 10 to the 74 seconds times the mass of the black hole in units of the mass of the Sun, cubed. If you prefer the number in units of years, that's about 10 to the 67 times the cube of the mass of the black hole in solar units. To give you a sense of scale, the lifetime of the universe so far is only 10 to the 10 years, so it's going to take a long time for black holes to evaporate. But evaporate they will. Assuming that nothing unexpected happens as the universe evolves, eventually the stars will burn out and clump together in ginormous black holes. The black holes will then slowly evaporate away, and the universe will consist of nothing but photons from the evaporation of black holes. But it's going to take a long time, so you still have to do your homework, paint your shed, mow your lawn, or whatever it is that you're avoiding. By the way, the mental picture I painted of how Hawking radiation works is useful, but it isn't the most accurate one. A more accurate version involves some very interesting effects. One is called the Unruh effect. In the Unruh effect, accelerating observers see the world differently than non-accelerating ones. Accelerating observers can see particles and patches of space where non-accelerating observers see nothing. And an object near the event horizon of a black hole will need to accelerate to avoid falling in, and this is the more nuanced explanation of the origin of Hawking radiation. I put a link in the video description to the more detailed explanation. It's pretty tricky, and I put it there if you're truly curious. But you know what also can be tricky? Viewers' questions, that's what. Sometimes they can be pretty hard. So let's go see what surprises our viewers have for us this week. It's question time, and boy, there were some doozies. I'd love to have answered more, but there were just too many good ones. So I picked a couple that many of you asked. Let's get started. A number of you came up with clever ways to pronounce my name, but a comment by neither Theorem nor Celery got my attention. There's got to be quite a story behind that YouTube handle, but I digress. Neither noted that my first name is pronounced the same in all languages. I suppose that could be true, but I do have a funny story to relate about that. I was giving a series of lectures in Medellin, Colombia, and I was assigned a student by the name of Sebastian to babysit me and make sure I stayed out of trouble. Amazing guy, by the way. He took me here and there and introduced me to a great number of people. We got to be friendly and chatted quite freely. Toward the end, he mentioned that it was sometimes awkward to introduce me because in Spanish, the word Don is an honorific, kind of like Don Corleone in The Godfather. I didn't really warrant the title. After all, I'm just a friendly neighborhood physicist. But I'm sure some people got the wrong impression, and I didn't have a clue. That's one of my many name mix-up stories from my travels. Okay, moving on. K, ha, a name I can pronounce right, asked why gravitational waves drop off linearly rather than as the square of the distance. Hi, K. Excellent question, with an unfortunately complicated answer. It comes down to the kinds of motions that cause gravitational waves compared to electromagnetic ones. In electromagnetic waves, if you have two charges of opposite sign and you move them away or towards one another, it will generate radiation of a form called dipole radiation. Dipole radiation decreases in intensity as the distance squared. But gravity doesn't emit dipole radiation. If you take two objects and separate them, conservation of momentum, energy, and angular momentum forbids dipole radiation. Only certain types of motion will emit radiation, and the simplest is when two masses orbit one another. This kind of radiation is called quadrupole radiation, and the amplitude falls off linearly as the distance. This is just a property of quadrupole radiation. There's a lot more to say about this, and I put a URL in the video description pointing to a nice article by Ethan Siegel on the topic. Plus, it has some very nice animated GIFs that are totally worth your time to look at. Check it out if you're interested. Zoltan asks what a person falling into a black hole will see of the surrounding universe. Hi, Zoltan. Such a person will see the opposite of what an outsider looking in sees. The person falling into a black hole will see their clock look unchanged, but distant clocks will speed up and appear bluer and bluer. But that spaghettification will still be a problem. Speaking of spaghetti, the internationally renowned philosopher Samuel Machado ponders what would happen if spaghetti fell into a black hole. Well, since spaghettification makes things longer and skinnier, I think the spaghetti would turn into angel hair pasta. Sounds reasonable to me, well, and yummy. What do you think? BBB F09 also addresses the spaghettification topic. He or she notes that spaghettification doesn't happen near supermassive black holes. Hi, BB. Yes, that's right. Let me explain to the viewers why. Spaghettification occurs not because of strong gravity, but because the gravity is different in two different locations. Let's start with two objects, both a kilogram in mass, separated by a meter. Let's look at two black holes. One with a mass of 5 solar masses, like a smallish black hole created from the collapse of a star, and another black hole the size of the huge monster lurking at the center of the Milky Way, with a mass of about 4 million solar masses, way bigger. By the way, I'll talk about these black hole heavyweights in an upcoming episode. The Schwarzschild radius of a small black hole is 9 miles, or 15 kilometers. The Schwarzschild radius of a monster black hole is 7.3 million miles, or about 11.7 million kilometers. Now let's ask what the gravity is for both black holes, say 15,000 meters above the event horizon. You're going to be surprised. By the way, these pictures aren't to scale. Near the stellar mass black hole, the gravity at that distance gives a 1 kilogram object that weighs 2.2 pounds on the Earth's surface a weight of 34 billion pounds. And the object a meter further away has a force that is 2.3 million pounds less. So the difference in gravity pulls the two objects apart with a force equivalent to 23 million pounds. That's where the spaghettification thing comes from. Now let's do the same thing with the supermassive black hole. We'll put two weights, one 15,000 meters above the event horizon and one 15,001 above it. The close object, which has a mass of a kilogram, experiences a weight of about 0.2 pounds, and the object a meter farther away experiences a weight that is only 36 trillionths of a pound less. So the two weights are roughly the same, and no spaghettification occurs. So, yep, Spaghettification is only for solar mass black holes, I guess, and smaller. And finally, in the best approximation tradition of introductory physics, Valdegas tells us the gravitational potential for a spherical, non-rotating cow is given by the Schwarzschild's mu trick. Hi, Valdegas. That was a horrible pun. Truly awful. You should be ashamed. So first, let me salute you. And then, I think you deserve more recognition, best demonstrated by two insightful lads by the name of Wayne and Garth.
We're not worthy! We're not worthy!
Okay, on that respectful note, I think we need to wrap up this episode. Thanks for all the questions, and sorry if I didn't get to yours. There were just too many good ones. As always, please like, subscribe, and share, and always remember the timeless motto of this video series. Even at home, physics is everything.